school. And I guess what I'm saying, the importance of father blood, the importance of the part the blood plays that can do in the biblical time, right up to the time Christ did up his life and went to the cross. It's always been important about the blood. But they say one thing, like, you shouldn't be talking to this. Well, something was saying about you shouldn't do something if it's not well done, or you know what I'm saying. You shouldn't eat the blood. And it was another thing saying, it just said blood was never discussed, and I just think it's something that's important, how important the blood is. The blood is important. You know, it was the blood that saved us, the blood of Jesus, that is still is covering us. So, I don't know. But maybe something
you
might want to think about.
Look at Hebrews 9th chapter. And we'll start there at verse 1.
Then indeed, even the first covenant had ordinance of divine service and the earthly sanctuary. For a tabernacle was prepared, the first part, which was the lampstand, the table, and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And behind the second veil, the part of the tabernacle, which is called the holiness of all, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid all sides with gold, which were the golden plot, and that had the manner, urn, wide, and bucket. And the tablet of the covenant, and above it were the cherubims.
Cherubims. That's plural. Cherubims. And so twain.
Of glory, overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things you cannot speak in detail. Can you keep going? Now then, these things have been thus prepared. The priests always went into the first part of the tabernacle, performing the services. But into the second part, the high priest went alone, once a year, not without blood, which he offered for himself, for the people's sins committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit indicated this, that the way into the holiness of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing.
No, so here is what we're doing with the blood, huh? No. Go ahead, what
was that? No, I just never saw that.
Okay. Because what we're doing, see, the Old Testament kind of conceals and the New Testament reveals, so what we're doing is we're going straight to the chase. During that time, for the remission of sins, this is the important piece of the blood. For the remission of the sins, you had to have blood sacrificed by an animal. You couldn't use man's blood. Why? Because we have blood in our blood. Sinful nature. So we have sin. So the animals had no sin. They didn't have any sin. So their blood was the blood that was to be used. So they did that. That's what they did. That was, the first part you read in verse 1 was the ordinance. Here's the ordinance. Here are the ordinance is another word, of course, for orders. Here are the orders that come from the Lord. You go in there, into the first part of that tabernacle, and you do the service, every so often that you do it. Okay? Then once a year, the high priest goes into the holies of holies, and he sprinkles blood on that mercy seat. That's what he does. He sprinkles blood. Now, when you go into the holies of holies, You first got to prepare yourself, and you got to have a blood sacrifice for yourself. Then you go in for the, you know, for the sacrifice of everyone else's sin. And what they would do is they would put a belt around it. They would not, they put a rope around the waist.
Mm-hmm.
And some would have it that you would actually ring a bell. Some would say that the bells along the hem of the garment would ring. But nevertheless, you kind of feed that rope in, and you kind of pull the slack back as they go around. And then the piece is that, you know, they drop dead in there and drag them on out, and the next person would prepare himself. The next high priest would prepare himself to go in. Because you couldn't go in there if you hadn't had your sins forgiven by the shedding of the blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Okay, well, keep going. We're in Hebrews, the 9th chapter, and we're going to verse 9 now. Verse 9.
It was symbolic for the present time in which both gifts and sacrifice are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to the conscience. Concerned
now, that is a key piece. And you know, you're not going to be perfect in there. It's one thing to go in and the sins are forgiven, but your conscience.
Mm-hmm.
Inside you, they haven't done anything to that. You know, so it's almost about time you get, before you get home good, you done messed up again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and you stand in need of another blood sacrifice. And keep going. Verse 10.
Okay. Concern only with food and drinks, various washings, and fleshy ornaments imposed until the time of reformation. What do you mean by reformation?
Keep going.
Okay. But Christ came at
Christ.
But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come, with a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation.
Right. So what's the tabernacle not made with hands? When we take communion, we're doing what? Two things. We're recognizing what? What did he give? From the communion table. His body. This bread represents his body. That's
right.
The tabernacle that was not made with hands. The blood represents just that, his blood. Remember, up until that time, nobody else's blood could do. Why? Because it was contaminated with sin. Right, so it was contaminated. So nobody else's blood would do it. You always had to have an animal sacrifice. Well, so now, here he comes with a greater and a more perfect. He's, you talk about something. Here he is, the judge. Here's the standard. Then he stays on the throne, but at the same time pours himself into a new tabernacle. Comes down, and he prepares the sacrifice, and then he is the sacrifice. And then he gives his life. Nobody else can fit that job description, that bill. Nobody else could do that. So he did. You know? That's why it's such a blessing. So he did what nobody else could do for us. That's why God is the only one that's got the right to be jealous. Ain't nobody else got the right to be jealous. God got the right. And you say, well, I thought jealousy was a bad thing. No, how can you put somebody else before him that has done so much for you and nobody else could do that? Nobody else could do it for you. You know, you got to be three things: ready, willing, and able. He's all three. He was ready to come. He was willing to come. Ready, willing, and he was able to do what needed to be done. And he did it. You can't beat that combination. Nobody else could do it but him, and he did. And if it was for nobody else but you, he would. Which is a humbling thing as well. That's why you see people that know this and have gripped this. That's why they like, And I wouldn't do all that if I was you. You live in it, but you don't know what he done for me. And that's why when they sung that song, "You Don't Know What He's Done For Me." He gave me the victory. I love him. I love him. And then they go into, "I really love the Lord." And then they try to put it in today's terms. "You don't love God? I love God. You don't love God? What's wrong with you?" So each generation has its own way. Once they get this, of trying to go ahead and help the generation that we serve get it. So read that verse again. We're in Hebrews 9th chapter. She's going to read verse 11 again and then keep on going.
"But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come, with greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, not with the blood of the goats of calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption."
So, they had to do it. Remember when we read earlier? They had to go, the high priest had to go in once a year. Every year, he sprinkled blood for the remission of the sins. So to get this picture, everybody had to bring the goats, the bulls, or whatever the sacrifice was to the temple. There was a ceremony of having the blood, having the animal killed, the blood put out and put in certain containers, and then that blood taken and put in there, and they would go through the ceremony of what they had to do to plead the blood of Jesus, plead the blood, you know, for the sacrifice, for our sins, for the atonement. But here it is, Jesus, he goes in, we're in Hebrews 9th chapter. How do you do? Okay.
Hebrews 9, verse 11.
Oh, anyway.
He's such a distraction.
So that's what happened. He did it once and for all.
That's what the message of the Bible says, once and for all.
Right. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Read it once again.
You said
in the message.
Yes.
"But when the Messiah arrived, high priest of the superior thing of this new covenant, he bypassed the old tent and its trappings, and his created world, and went straight into the heaven's tent, the true holy place, once and for all."
See, so it was one of the ways that we know that the sacrifice of Jesus giving his body and his blood was received is because on the day of ascension, when he rose up and he went out of our sight, went out of their sight into heaven, he said that what would happen, I'll come right there, he said that what would happen is that the Father will send the Holy Spirit in my name. Mm-hmm. So by virtue of what happened in Acts, the second chapter, the Holy Spirit coming in like a rushing mighty wind, and that's how we know that the sacrifice was acceptable to the Heavenly Father that Jesus has made. Because he went straight on into the presence of God in the heavenly and the heavens. Okay? You had a... No, she was reading out of the Message Bible. You got the Amplified right there?
No.
Oh. Listen. No problem. No problem. I like both of them. The Amplified, the Message. Matter of fact, there's one called the NCD, New Century Version of the Bible. And one of the reasons why I like the New Century Version of the Bible, and it's written in 20th century English, but here's the thing, it's written on a third grade reading level. And some people say, "Well, man, look, I can read all this other stuff, and that's an insult." No, I like it simple. So you go for the simplicity. So that New Century Version of the Bible, you really, I haven't really seen it anywhere except online with the Bible app. But the New Century Version of the Bible is a third grade reading level. It really makes it simple. The Message Bible is a paraphrase Bible. So he comes up with his own, he reads this, comes up with his own way of saying it, and paraphrases what this says, which is good as well. And the Amplified just simply turns it up. And I told you about the Amplified. If I said, everybody in here got on shoes, you'd say, yeah, okay. But then when we start describing what type of shoes everybody has on, that's what the Amplified does for you. It helps you to understand a whole lot better. Okay, so Hebrews 9th chapter. And we did verse 13, right? We did 12 and 13, mm-hmm. Now 14. 13.
For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from the dead works to serve the living God?
All right, so here it is, he's showing that, think about it, if the blood of bulls and goats and all, and ashes of a heifer sprinkled unclean, sanctified to purifying of the flesh, if it did that then, how much more now? You know, because another thing about the animal that you run, you had to bring an animal that was as close to perfection as possible, close to perfect as possible. You couldn't bring no lame animal, no sick animal up there. Mm-hmm. You had to bring something that you really, if there was any other way, you would keep that one and bring this other. But you had to bring. So now here it is, Jesus is coming, and he did this thing, and without spot, with no sin at all. Mm-hmm. See, when the Holy Spirit overshadowed Mary, she became impregnated. Because he had to be born, so that's his humanity part. But his conception was from the Holy Spirit, the Father, the God. And it had no sin in it at all. And so his task, his assignment was never to sin. And he's the only one that ever lived that never sinned. Adam and Eve, they were created without, but they sinned. So they messed it up for everyone around them. But Jesus had no sin. And that's why he's the perfect sacrifice. All right? Then 15.
And for this reason, he is the mediator of the new covenant by means of death, for the redemption of the transgression under the first covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance.
All right, so you have the Old Covenant, or known as the New Old Testament, and you have the New Testament, or New Covenant. So, you know, covenant is not, you wouldn't use the word contract, because mm-hmm. contract can be broken. Mm-hmm. You use covenant because here's an agreement that God is saying, here's an agreement that I'm making with you. That's what we're looking at. I'm making this with you. So he's telling us here is a new covenant, a new testament that he's making with us. You with me? All right. Hebrews 9th chapter, and we're going into verse, also in that verse 15, and he's the mediator.
Even now.
So he mediated the new covenant, the new testament, and he stands now as a mediator for us. So that's why when you pray to the Father mm-hmm. by the power of the Holy Spirit mm-hmm. in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's important to know his will and his work, what he wants us to be doing, because he says, if you ask anything of me, I'll give it. Now, that the Father may be glorified. See, if you don't know how the Father is, and how the Son is, and how the Holy Spirit is, you could be asking for stuff you ain't no need to even look for. But it's not going to glorify the Father.
That's why we say, if we ask, we got that. It means it is God's will. Like he said, when people pray, I just say, well, I say, please answer the prayers, but let it be God's will. Whatever they pray for, let it be what God's will. Right?
I'm
going
to make we're going to stay right there.
Right.
But Second Chronicles, don't go there, don't turn there yet. Second Chronicles chapter 20. Don't let me forget that once we finish this. I'll give you a good example of praying in the will of God. Second Chronicles chapter 20. Alright. Keep on going.
Okay, 16.
Hebrews 9 chapter verse 16.
For what thou is a testament, thou must also of a necessity be the death of the tester. For a testament is in force after men are dead, since it has no power at all while the testator lives. Therefore, not even the first covenant was dedicated without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves, goats, with water, and scarlet wood, and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book itself and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the covenant which God has commanded you. Then likewise he sprinkled with the blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry, and according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood. And without shedding the blood, there is no remission.
So without shedding the blood, there is no remission. So he sprinkled everything.
Blood purifies.
We're dealing with symbolicness. But he also did it. He physically took it, and he, just like if I was to have the blood doing it back in Moses' time, then I would personally come and sprinkle everybody with the blood. Now you see a lot in Catholicism, you see them still sprinkling holy water. Mm-hmm. It's kind of similar to what was going on back during that particular time. But, you know, they symbolically did that, okay? All right, so that's what he did. This was for the remission. All right, 23.
Therefore, it was necessary that the copies of these things in the heavens should be purified with these. But the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ had not entered the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us.
So now, before you get there, here's the thing. The tabernacle that was built in the wilderness, when you get a chance to look up the tabernacle, how you had the inner court, the outer court, and how you had the holy place and the most holy, and all these things, was symbolic of how things were in heaven. It was a representation of it. So Christ came, and he's taking us so much further, because that's where he actually came from, is from heaven. And so he's going back to heaven, but here's the thing that he went through. He made himself a sacrifice by honoring what God wanted him to do. Continue on.
That he should offer himself often as the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood of another. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of men. To those who eagerly await for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation.
Mm-hmm. So, there it is laid out for you. The whole thing in a nutshell is, he came, you know, this time, John said it the best for me. He said, behold, the Lamb of God came to take away the sins of the world. Mm-hmm. So that's why he came. He came to take away the sins of the world. He didn't come to try to be your judge. This particular time, he came to be your savior. Now, when he comes back, it's a different story. When he comes back, he's coming back as a lion. So coming back to meet us there in the air. Those who are ready, those who are looking for his coming. All right? Those that are looking for him to come, we will be caught up. Or if we've already passed, we will be raptured. We'll be resurrected. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So you're present with the Lord. And then what happens is, when the trump of God sounds, you leave him to come get your body and come on back up to be with him. Now what happens to that body on the way up? Corruptible puts on incorruptible. Mortality puts on immortality. You say, what if the body's turned to dust? God's got to give it up. When the call comes, it's not no put on hold. Wait a minute, let me check and see if they're there. None of that. No matter what, you coming to get your bodies and go on back up. And those of us that are like, we're standing here or sitting here, now we'll just leave. And we'll leave in these physical bodies that we have, but on the way up we will put on bodies that will have no, they can't die. Immortality. So mortal has to put on immortality. And corruption, we're able to sin here, we won't be able to sin there.
It said that we will be changed within the people of now.
Right.
That is the change of the body. Is that what they're talking about? Mm-hmm. We'll be changed for this in the body. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. 1 Corinthians, you don't have to go there right now. 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, is what it talks about, starting with verse 50 and working your way on down. This corruption has to put on incorruption. Mm-hmm. You know, and this mortal has to put on immortality. So that's how it will be going on up. You know, and that's our belief, that's our trust, that's our hope, that's where we stand. That's why when we come to homegoing services, we cry, we might hoot, we might holler, but we don't do none of that as if we have no hope. Because we know in our hearts, according to God's word, which we are believers, that we will see them again. It's not easy going to homegoing service. But I tell you, it's much easier going to a homegoing service than a funeral when you don't know whether they did or didn't. That's why some people say, well, the way I live my life is just me. No, it ain't. Because somebody gonna, you know, either be at your funeral or hear about it. You know. And they gonna, it's bad to leave folks questioning. Because you preach your own funeral before you get there. That's why it was so ironic with Martin Luther King. When Martin Luther King passed, he just pressed play. He already preached. You know, I hope in my living, you know, my living won't be in vain, you know, because, I tried to preach the homework. I tried to call the name. I tried to, you know, go see about being in jail. I did these things. So he just pressed play. And he'd already preached. And wasn't nothing else. He rolled down Sweet Auburn Avenue and took the barrel. So that's the way it is. You want to do that.
Okay? But you've got to, regardless of anything, because I tried to tell somebody one time, I said, you still got to say, and you still got to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he died and he was resurrected. I hope I wasn't wrong by saying, you can't make him to heaven if you don't believe that. If you don't believe that Jesus was the Son of God, how you going to?
Well, I actually tell you, you know, there's no other name given unto man whereby we must be saved. And how do you get saved is what you just made mention. What happened? I believe he died. Mm-hmm. For what? For my sins. Did he stay dead? No. I believe that he got up, you know, basically never to die again. Mm-hmm. He got up with all power in his hand. And I've asked him to come into my heart and be my Savior. 23 years ago, the 19th of December, 1993. Mm-hmm. So the whole thing in that show is there ought to be a point in time when your life takes on, this is how I used to be, this is how I am now. Mm-hmm. And you're growing. You ought to be able to see some growth.
Yeah, absolutely.
You don't see any growth.
Absolutely.
Amen? Mm-hmm. And you see, when you understand that, that's why you can look at people And you don't have to trip because they need to grow. You get in and then you start growing, then you start changing. You try to change it out there, and then come again. That's saying that, well, I don't need you to change. I don't need you to fix me. I can fix myself. Good luck at that. What you're dealing with, luck. I need to know. Okay? All right. Any other questions or thoughts? Yes, sir. Say, for example, a person was an amputee here. There won't be one there.
Right.
Say, if they walk with a cane here, there won't be no cane there. They could have been blind here. There won't be blind there. So the only thing is, we'll be whole there. That's the good thing. So long now, but because we were not made to die. But the other piece of that is the only thing that Jesus did keep was the nail scarred hands and the nail scarred feet, as he did keep where he was pierced in the side. So he kept that. Right. Exactly right. So he kept that so that he could be recognized. As I was saying, blood was poured out for us. And then plus the resurrection body is able to appear and able to disappear. Because if you walk on the road with them along Emmaus, on the road to Emmaus, he just appeared and they saw him and then they got to talking with him and he got to raise the question, why are y'all so sad? What's wrong with y'all? They got to talking along, and then he told them from the Old Testament and how these things must pass about what he did. And then when he sat down to break bread with them, as he broke bread, and he blessed it and he gave it, he vanished out of the sight. And all is given.
I'll call it down to transfiguration. He recognized those lies and problems and those he recognized. So, you know, even the disciples, their eyes were open.
Right.
So that they
recognize
them
coming together. And that's two important facts, two important points that we deal with. The Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus disappeared. He revealed, like, they left the way they left. Moses left. Elijah left. You know, the way that they left. And that's how they looked. But great point, Jesus was able to open the disciples with him, Peter, James, and John's eyes, so they could see. And then they saw Jesus, but then they were able to see that, okay, this is Moses and this is Elijah. So God allowed them to be able to see some stuff. It'd be amazing if God would open our eyes and let us see what's in there.
Because we were created to know everything. We were created to know everything. You know, there were no limits to us. Another point on the Mount of Transfiguration was when
they wanted to worship them. And God spoke and said, no. You know, this is my son. You know, you need to, this is the one. You know, not them. Mm-hmm. He's the one. You need to worship.
Exactly. And then actually, when there was a cloud that overshadowed, once the cloud overshadowed, then they saw nobody but Jesus. And that's symbolic because worship God and Him only, don't worship anyone else. So to go back to your question, yes, that's what we believe, that we'll be known as we are known.
You also say it's good that your wife said what she said, because you don't think about these things. Right. But I'm thinking, I said, well, wait, they was probably wasn't even born when Moses was around. But I never thought of that way. So that's why it's so important that we have these Bible studies. Mm-hmm. Because you always got somebody that's going to point out something you never think. That's why you can't get the Bible down. You're going to come up with something. You're going to read something and you're going to say, because I've done it. I'm like, wait, I don't remember singing that. But just what she said, I'm like, wow. Yeah, they wasn't even born then, so God had to open up
the eyes. Just like with the gentleman that was the prophet Elijah. Mm-hmm. You know, when he was, you know, the king had sent his soldiers out and they were surrounding him. And him and his servants and their nerve were. And, you know, it's like, how can he not be worried? Don't you see this army surrounding us? You know, these God folk, man, these people be following God sometimes. I don't think they screwed on right. You know, that's what sometimes folk can be thinking. How can you be sitting here so calm with all of this? He went back there in the back room and he said, Lord, open his eyes so he can see. He went back out there and what had him surrounded was surrounded itself with angels. With flaming swords, ready to go ahead and do God's bid. You know, so the whole thing in a nutshell, it was a fixed fight. Yeah, they won't fight, but I mean, God had, what angel came in the camp one night and killed up thousands? Just one. One angel. And that's why when Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross right before he left the garden, and Peter done pulled out a little knife. cut off the soldier's ear. I like dude was so cool about it. He said, no, pay him. We ain't gonna do all that. That's not how this is going. I called out 12 legions of angels. 72,000. You know, 72,000. If one angel would kill one of about 40,000 in a night, what age? Earth would have known what happened. and it's quick. I mean, it doesn't take. It's for all folks you say like this.
They're not the little cherubims and little cherubims. Oh, no. You see, they're fierce. Yeah. If we would die, I mean, just looking at them, our heart would literally not be in our chest to see the way the scriptures describe angels. I mean, they're warriors. They come to just wipe out.
Well, pretty much everywhere angels appear in the Bible, the folks just, the first thing the angel had to say is, fear not. Because, I mean, I don't know if anybody's ever had fear just grip you. You don't know whether to run that way, run this way, run that way, run through what's in front of you, run that. You don't know what you just. And so, you know, even when they came to roll back the tomb, the stone from the tomb, one angel just came up there, and the soldiers, big, strong Roman soldiers, standing up there guarding the tomb, they just fell out. Just fell. I ain't like it. The Bible said, tell all that dead men. The angel just went ahead on this. Now it took strong men to roll the stone up. But you see, it's like a circle. Mm-hmm. And what they do is, and it sits in like a cylinder, like this. And so they put, you know, some stuff right here to hold it. And then they pull it back, and what happens is it rolls and it sits right in there. And then they put a seal on it so that nobody can go in there. If you break that seal, they take hot wax and they would take his ring, whoever was in charge, take the ring, put it in the wax, and put their seal up there. Big gaudy ring. Put that seal up there. Once that seal, if somebody break that seal, you die. You didn't have to go to court, didn't have to talk about it, you just kidding. So the angel just comes over here and he breaks the seal and sits on top of it. You know, and they land there like dead men. You know, and all of them supposed to be killed. Because if you fall asleep on God, even today, and you don't really have to take you to court martial. They just going, they lie to leave you laid out there. So all these things are so relevant that we understand about the Lord. This is just the way that we are. Did you have your hand? Any other questions? Yeah, yes, ma'am.
When our mother and father just passed away, will we die and go to heaven? Will they be our parents or will we see brothers and sisters in Christ?
That's a good point. They will still, of course, be our parents, but we will go to Hebrew. And I told you a bit about Jeremiah. Priests of God. Okay. So that's basically what we would end up being. Now for more information, and the Training Institute this year, I'll be dealing with a 1,000-year reign of the Lord. A lot of people don't understand when we pray certain things, a lot of people don't understand what we're actually praying. You've heard of the Lord's Prayer. Mm-hmm. How would it start out? Stop right there. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Where?
On earth.
As it is in heaven. 1,000 years, that's what's going to happen. He's going to come back. He's going to run back. 1,000 years upon the face of the earth. We'll be there with him. Yeah. There will be no more death with us. We don't have to worry about that. We will reign with him for 1,000 years. We'll be priests under him. So brothers and sisters will be more of a concept that it would be mother or father from the standpoint of giving instructions and telling us what to do and how to do and things of that nature. It would be more mother, more brother, sister. it'd be kind of like what you, when you read Jude. Jude doesn't say, now look, y'all listen to me, because after all, Jesus is my half brother. No, he's my Lord. James comes the same way. You know, neither one of them comes off as trying to say, look, you know, I want you to listen to me because it's my half brother. It's not about that kind of a brother thing. It's we're sisters and brothers in Christ. And when we go there, we'll be sisters and brothers in Christ. And we will recognize one another.
But it won't be
none of
that. Oh,
well, no, I mean, I would, I don't see where there wouldn't be any of the, I'm glad to see mama, I'm glad to see dad. You know, I think one of the reasons why, and this is Pierre, I think one of the reasons why the Lord wipe away our tears when we get there, we won't have to cry anymore, but we'll cry for two reasons. One, for those that are there. And one for those that are not there. And then he'll wipe away the tears for heaven. So that's something that we are thankful about. Okay? And I saw another hand up on.
Okay, the Lord's Prayer in Matthew, I think it's 6th, 9th chapter.
Yes, sir.
And is it another one in there anyway?
Another prayer? Yeah. For, well,
because I'm going to say it. He said, mine said, thy Father, thy will, I be thy name, I think it's done. That would be done. In earth, as it is in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say, on earth, you know, they do it on
earth. Right. Yeah, and that's, like I said, a lot of people don't realize that actually what they're dealing with is here in chapter 20 of Revelation. You know, because his will be done on earth. And then the devil, you know, you read the next verse, and then the devil will be let out, he'll be loose for a little while, for a little season. Lord, I'm still trying to deceive. And some people say, well, it must be possible during that 1,000 years for you to get saved. Look, don't wait. I don't know. I'm not recommending that. I'm saying, before you come back, you need to go ahead and get saved. Yes, ma'am.
I just kind of want to grab a little bit of what she was talking about. I think what, in my mind, if you're just reading scripture, when we change, when the transformation occurs, I don't think our mindset will be as we know it now. I think what's going to happen in that transformation is we're going to go back to what we were intended and created for. That's worship. I think our mindset will be changed to seek out, and we're going to desire God. We're going to be changed and created to worship him wholeheartedly. And when we see those that we loved in New Year, we'll recognize them, but it won't be our focus. Our focus and our heart, that thirst and that yearning, that hunger, will be to worship God. I think that's what's going to happen during the transformation, because that's what we were created for. We were created to worship him. And I think once we drop off all the things that keep us bound and keep us separated from really truly worshiping God wholeheartedly, we'll understand it there. Because I think in my spirit, I know that's what God created us for, to worship and share his love with us and through us, that we would be an extension of him here. But sin has separated us from our created purpose. So I think once the transformation comes, we won't be caught up in thinking that, oh, I'm going to see mom. Our mind is going to be, oh, I'm thirst for righteousness. And I'm hungry for my reunion with you. Oh, God, my Savior, my Lord. That's where our mindset's going to be. That's where the transformation is going to take us, back in communion with God. Because we don't have anything separating us from being before him. Because this separates us. We can't take this in front of his presence. We can't. But when we take off this
immortality, mm-hmm.
and put on immortality,
we're
going to come
in
connection with our created purpose.
Right now, we see dimly through the glass, but as the songwriter said, as they mentioned, we'll understand it better by and by. So, yeah, we'll go more into what we were created for, what we were created to worship him. And that's why when Adam sinned, the first thing he wanted to do was hide away from him. And so that's why it's so still dangerous today. When you don't want to go to church, you don't feel like going, you feel like, no, anything but that, I won't be around no churchy folk today, I don't want to hear no Hallelujah. Amen. You gotta be careful of that kind of thing. Really, you need to run the church at that particular time, because you get to the place. It's going, first of all, there's something that the enemy's trying to keep you from. That you need to get. Sometimes you can be good case in point. In Luke, it talks about a man, Simeon, that had prayed all his life to see the Messiah. If he had a skipped church that day, wow, what you've been praying for all your life. So a lot of times what you've been looking for is there. You just miss it. You don't get there. But that day, the baby was brought into the temple. And as soon as he walked in to go do what he normally does, let me see with my own eye. I don't need to see no more. I mean, I don't need to see the baby grow up. I want him to see my eye, and you put in my spirit right here, right now, that there he is. That's him. But if he ever said, I ain't going today, he'd have missed it. You know what I'm saying?
Just one thing. Yes. What you was talking about, when we take on, when we're transformed, we'll be like him. Mm-hmm. And we'll see him as he really is.
Yes.
And that's how I know our focus will be on work.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so paramount.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's part of why it's so hard to do it here, because that's one thing the devil wants. He wants us to worship him. And if we can't get us to worship him, then anything else besides God will do. Worship your children. Worship your husband. Worship your wife. Worship your career. Worship everything else that's going to perish. One day you ain't going to be able to clock in. You know, I don't care how many hours you're going to put in, you ain't going to be able to clock in. I don't care how faithful you were on that time, you ain't going to be able to clock in. You know, one day, if you live long enough, I want to see one funeral where I think the husband died 1 week and the next week the wife died, and they were able to have the funeral of the husband and the wife the same day. So rarely does it happen. One of them is going to go before the other. And if that's all you was holding on to was her, or that's all you was holding on to was him, then that's why when some people pass, their whole world ceased to exist, because all that, no, you don't put this in God. The one who has died, never to die again. Are you with me?
Amen.
The one who loves you enough to come and die for you in the first place. Are you with me?
Amen.
So you don't put it in a career, you don't put it in people, you put it in God. And by serving God, you end up serving people. Because you want to see souls saved and lives changed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Now we'll hasten on in closing to 2 Chronicles. It's in there. It's in there, I saw it. Second Chronicles, chapter 20. Chronicles chapter 20, start at verse 1.
After this, the armies of the Moabites, the Ammonites, and some of the Unionites, declared.
So here's the deal. When he's in trouble, here's an army coming. And so he prayed that the Lord would give him guidance. Now notice what happened in prayer. Start at verse 5.
Jehoshaphat stood before the community of Judah in Jerusalem, in front of the new courtyard at the temple of the Lord. He prayed, O Lord, God of our ancestors, you alone are the God who is in heaven. You are ruler of all the kingdoms of the earth. You are powerful and mighty. No one can stand against you. O our God, you did not drive out those who lived in this land when your people, Israel, arrived. And did you not give this land forever to the descendants of your friend Abraham?
Now stop right there. You can see how he's doing it. First of all, you got to start with when you pray, you need to recognize God and handle it. Mm-hmm. See, oftentimes when we pray, we it's like a last resort. It's like, you know, I'm going to throw a prayer in there, just that's going to kind of work. No, he's praying. He said, look, I'm recognizing who you are. Mm-hmm. Not only in this generation, but in past generations, how you've done things. I recognize that you are the ruler. You're over all the kingdoms. So he's recognizing God for who he is and what he can do based on what he's already done. And then he goes into some more stuff of what he has done. You know, verse 7, art not thou our God? See, he's recognizing, I'm with you, you with me. We got a relationship here. You know. Then he goes into, you know, who didst drive out the inhabitants of this land before thy people Israel. So once again, he's rehearsing the history. You ran the people off this land and gave it to us. You understand what I'm saying? And so he goes into that. Now verse 8 continues.
Your people settled here and built this temple to honor your name. They said, whenever we are faced with any calamity, such as war, plague, or famine, we can come to stand in your presence. For this temple, where your name is honored, we can cry out to you and you save us. You will hear us and rescue us.
You will hear us and you will rescue us. Amen. You'll hear us and you'll help us in King James. So he's rehearsing, you see, and trust me, that's why it's so hard to come to church. Because if you hear what he said, and you're facing something, look up here. What you're facing, if you don't watch it, it will try to like overcome you and be too big and too much. But when you recognize God and you remind him of what he said, you said that you would help me. You said that you would rescue me. Are y'all hearing? Mm-hmm. He's going over what he has said. Before we even talk about, because you got to get your mind right. Mm-hmm. You got to get your heart right. You know, a lot of times people say, well, I prayed. What you need to do is go on and start praising. And then go back and pray. Mm-hmm. Praise it first. Because your mind, like this woman or this man at this job is too much and you can't. What? Man, woman, job, can't, too much for you? What? God can't handle it. Somebody he made, a creation, he came up. You're thinking the wrong way. So you need to pray, Lord, I know you made the heavens and all that there is, and the earth and everything that dwelleth upon it, and that was, is, and shall be. So you got to get your mind right. Then, keep going.
Verse 8.
Abel,
the king.
Okay, I'm sorry. Now, see what he's doing? He had a now in there. He said, now, see this. I want you to see this army. Now, you wouldn't let them destroy them. And now, look, here's the reward. They out there getting ready to mess with your people. Keep going.
For they have come to throw us out of your land, which you gave us as an inheritance.
That's what I'm talking about. Throw us out of the land that you. See, you got to know what he's done. You got to know what he said.
Oh, our God, won't you stop him? We are powerless against
when you don't know what to do, you see how this boy praying, this king, he praying, man, I don't know what to do, I know who to come to,
yeah,
but I don't know what to do. Won't you do something? I'm asking humbly, I'm not like, you got to do something. No, not like that. I'm praying humble about this thing. Keep going.
As all the men of Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, wives, and children, the Spirit of the Lord came upon one of the men standing there. His name was Jahaziel, son of Zechariah, son of Benaniah, son of Jael, son of Mattaniah, a Levite, who was the descendant of Asaph.
Mm-hmm. The singers, the musicians.
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
He said, listen, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem, listen, King Jehoshaphat, this is what the Lord says. Do not be afraid. Don't be discouraged by this mighty army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, march out against them. You will find them coming up through the ascent of Ziz at the end of the valley that opens into the wilderness of Jeruel. But you will not even need to fight. Take your positions, then stand still and watch the Lord's victory. He is with you. O people of Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid or discouraged. Go out against them tomorrow, for the Lord is with you.
And the Lord is with you. So as you can see, you pray until something happens. So how long do I need to pray? Until something happens. Yeah. So, you know, I pray. Well, what you going to do? I don't know. See, here is the king. Now, I don't know. I'm going to go pray. Y'all come. We're going to go pray. Children, my everybody. Everybody come. We're going to pray and we're going to watch God fix this thing. Why? I don't know. Then the Spirit of the Lord came up on the prophet. He raised up a prophet in the midst of their struggle to give an answer from the Lord. Tomorrow you're going out there and face that enemy. I'm not going to tell you where you're going to find them. Right over there. You're going to find them right over there. You're going up there. And you don't need to fight in this battle. Just stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. You're going to see something. You're going out there tomorrow. And as you get a chance to finish reading the chapter, verse 20, matter of fact, we'll skip to a few points. Verse 21.
After consulting the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. This is what they sang. Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. At the very moment they began to sing and give praise, the Lord caused the armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir to start fighting among themselves. The armies of Moab and Ammon turned against their allies from Mount Seir and killed every one of them. After they had destroyed the army of Seir, they began attacking each other. So when the army of Judah arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw were dead bodies lying on the ground as far as they could see. Not a single one of the enemy had escaped.
So here it is, what you worried about. If you just go pray about it, God can go ahead and give. Now, he said, now go on out there to the lookout point. And by the time they got to the lookout point, what they went to look for was dead. Now, but they got the word that this great army was coming. And sure enough, it came. And they're going to turn right around, kill the army that came with them, then turn around and start killing themselves. So a lot of times what we worried about, you know, God already done worked it out. He already done fixed it. All you need to do is go and pray. Mm-hmm. How long do I pray? Until something happens. 10 minutes, 10 days, 10 years, whatever. Keep on praying. Keep on looking. Because what I will learn about prayer is God can either fix it for you and change it, or he can change you in the midst of it. So stuff that used to would bother you, be like water off a duck's back. It won't even bother you. Mm. Any questions or thoughts? Thank you for your patience. We ask for all of those to remember Sister choir. We're going straight to the memorial service, and then we're gonna receive friends and family and the fellowship all the families. And keep Minister Justice Jackson in the back. He's given a fit in the bed for a while, so keep it in the bed. And then Kenneth Williams, Peter Williams. He's trying to come down some kind of vibe. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for letting us come here today. And we thank you, Lord, for the topics that came before. We pray, Lord, that we have given sufficient answers that are pleasing to you. Father, we pray right now for Sister Alice Russ. Pray, Lord, that you would be with her in the passing of her husband. Pray that you would help them, family, along the way. Continue to help us as a church family reach out to them, come down to see about them. And Father, we pray, Lord, that even with this memorial service, the souls will be saved and eyes will be changed. Father, we pray for Minister Jackson that you bless him. Lord, pray that you straighten out his back, Lord, and allow him to feel wonderful. And then, Father, we pray for Kenneth. Lord, that this virus will pass and that he'll be doing just wonderfully well as well. And then, Father, remember each and every one of us here at Southern Baptist. Bless us one by one and name by name. Help us, Lord, to remind this world the reason for the season. Help us, Lord, to not be ashamed to say anything about our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, the coming King that came